15th. I hope everyone's week went well. So we're going to get started. And at this time, we do have a new addition to our team. So I want to take this moment and pass it to Mayor Moran to make introductions.
Thank you, Council President. And once again, thank you to Council members for your service. Again, not to sound redundant, but I wanted to publicly introduce once again the new member to our team who is sitting for the first time at the table, our new managing director, and that being Mr. Bill Himes, who is confident that is going to work with each and every one of us to assist to and help us move the city of Reading forward. So, to have him alongside of me, I am honored to have somebody of his quality, his caliber, assist in that incredibly important position. However, with that said, I cannot lose the opportunity to also extend my gratitude again to someone that has held the reins for the last 5 months, and that being Mr. Frank Domboski. I kid you not when I say that I think in the 20 plus years that Mr. Domboski has worked for the city of Reading in one form or the other, have always shown the best interest and his heart has poured for the betterment of this community. However, I didn't see that as much as I have the last 5 months. This young man gave pour his heart, even during challenging times in his own health, which he has not kept a secret, to improve the quality of life in the city of Reading. I don't know if I would have done, again, if I had not had on my side to assist us all in guiding us in the last 5 months. So for that, Frank, again, publicly, I say thank you. My hat off to you. I couldn't have done it without you. So again, it's such a hard way to find words to send my gratitude. So, but for whatever's worth, I say thank you on behalf. I think I speak of the rest of the administration. I think I speak on behalf of the constituency. I think I speak on behalf of our partners that you have assist in creating that already by saying, thank you, brother. I also like to acknowledge that he is now officially as of Friday back as a, although he has made some decisions that will be shared later on this week. So thank you very much, Council President, for allowing me to introduce and giving me an opportunity to say thank you. Please allow me to ask for one more round of applause for Frank, please.
Thank you, Mayor, and we echo. At this time, if Mr. Heim would like to say a few words, we get into our agenda.
Just that I really appreciate the confidence that the mayor and council has shown in my appointment. And of course, I'll do my very, very best to help everybody move the city forward, which is what we all want to do. So thank you for your confidence.
Thank you so much. Welcome to the team. We look forward to working with you. Okay, at this time, we're going to get right into the item is solid waste update. And we have Steve Haverty, who's joining us virtually. Steve, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. I have a PowerPoint here I'm going to put up. Can you guys see that?
Not yet.
How about now?
No.
Hold on one second.
Does he have a screen? And Steve, Linda's checking to see if
okay.
What if you have a sharing screen abilities? He does. Steve, are you? Because nothing's coming through.
Steve, do you want me to talk you through it?
Linda and I tried it earlier. We did a test run and it seemed to work fine.
Okay. I have just need to highlight the window you want to share.
How's that?
No.
You try opening the file and leaving it open?
Yeah. Yep. It's funny because it worked fine earlier.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, to do my report, I can do it without the PowerPoint.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, and I can't pull up the email.
Steve, are you able to send the presentation to Linda? See if she can open it up on this end.
Sure. There you go, Linda. Just send it over. Said if not, I could just do it without it.
All right, so let's get started. Well, I guess that email's in transit. Oh, you found it.
There we go.
Okay, we have it, Steve.
Okay, you're ready to roll. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you, everyone, for having me in, and welcome back, Bill. It's good to see you. And Frank, thank you so much for your service to our city. I took over this role in February of 2021, and it was a challenging year, to say the least. So we're going to go through some of the challenges we face, some of the accomplishments, and some of the needs that we have in the Solid Waste Division. So first of all, 2021, we transitioned to a single hauler system. And at the time I took over 2021, we experienced a significant snowfall, and it made some of the narrow hair streets inaccessible. So the City of Reading Solid Waste staff helped out with Republic, and we ended up getting done. We were 2 or 3 days behind when I took over. And then throughout summer and fall, Republic, just like a lot of organizations throughout the world, had a serious worker shortage. And we worked with them, and they ended up reallocating some resources they had in other areas, and we were able to complete service to our people without any interruptions. So 2021, like I said, it was a landmark year for the Solid Waste and Recycling Program. 2021 saw the transition from multiple haulers to citywide service with Republic. And we went from 23,000 solid waste customers on January 1st to 26,500 on December 31st. And currently it's somewhat above that. It's around 26,600. So currently 94% of all the residential trash accounts are on the citywide system with Republic Services. And the remainder of the 28,000 potential accounts will default to city MSW, which is municipal solid waste trash collection, over the next 3 years as the existing contracts they have expire. And like I said, currently we have 28,047 residential units that have the recycling service by Republic as well. And also in 2021, we negotiated and approved a new 5-year trash and recycling service contract with Republic, and we still managed to maintain a lower monthly cost per unit at $27.50, which is lower than almost all of the municipalities around us. And we set higher service standards, and it's resulting in lower missed stops so far in 2022. So one of the primary issues for 2021 and prior years, like I said, was missed stops. So as part of the contract, we have higher accountability standards in the new contract and increased and improved communication with residents and the hauler and consistent performance monitoring in the field. I'm out there mostly every day following the trucks around, seeing what they're doing, making sure that everything's getting done and getting done right. For the calendar year of 2021, there was an average of 189 missed stops per month out of 100,204 units serviced. That's 24,000 times 4 weeks. And we missed 40 missed recycling stops out of 112,000 possible stops in a month. So year to date in 2022, we've had an average of 88 missed stops per month out of the same number and 20 missed recycling stops per month on average. So we've made tremendous strides in that. And a lot of it has to do with better communication with the hauler and just holding them more accountable. And monitoring in the field, being out in the field is very important. It's critical to making sure that they're doing what they need to do. Okay, also moving forward in 2022, we recently added two sweeps officers to the property maintenance division, and their role primarily is to help educate and enforce trash and recycling related issues in conjunction with increased accountability from our hauler through consistent communication and monitoring of collections. So we're doing a better job all around there, and we're doing more in the way of warnings, ticketing, education, and so forth, something we didn't do much of in the past or not as much as we need to do. And we also hired a clean city coordinator, Ryan Bradley, who's doing a very nice job, and he's coordinating targeted neighborhood cleanups. He's recruiting and facilitating volunteers and neighborhood organizations, and he's doing an outstanding job with the Adopt-A-Block program. Just last week, we put the first signs up for the Adopt-A-Block program over on 2nd Street in front of Opportunity House, and there's many, many more to come. So Ryan's doing a nice job for us. And we also hired a community outreach and education coordinator, Johnny Vasquez, who's a local DJ, he's a well-known guy, and he's doing a nice job. He's going to be out in the schools. He's going to be out in the community. He's going to be on social media, in line with Mayor Moran's vision for a cleaner and safer city. So we're excited to have Johnny on board. He's doing a nice job for us as well. Okay, next is a collection getting map. Pretty much self-explanatory. If you look at Monday, it's kind of strange. We have part of the route on one side of town, part of the route on the other. But it seems to work pretty well, and we've been doing it the same way for about 4 or 5 years now. And Tuesday seems to be our heaviest day, but it's pretty well balanced, and it, like I said, it's been working pretty well for us. One of the issues that we're dealing with and working on is the staging of trash. And by staging, I mean putting out of trash. There's a couple pictures there with some examples of properly staged trash. Now, in the ordinance, we do not require people to have cans. I'm sure you're all aware we've got some logistic issues in the city with these small baker's alleys and so forth. You're not required to have one, but we do want folks to use decent quality bags. And your trash is supposed to be put about in the evening before, after 5 p.m. or prior to 6 a.m. on collection day to make sure it gets picked up. Again, those are some examples of the proper way to stage your trash. And conversely, here's a couple pictures of the improper way to stage your trash. And we have entirely too much of this, and it's another thing that we've been working on with the two sweeps officers, giving folks friendly warnings and unnecessary ticketing people. What happens in this situation is you get rodents will break into them, or if you pick them up, they'll break. They're like store bags you would get from Giant a lot of times, and it creates quite a mess. So the criteria we have is you can have up to 4 30 to 55 gallon bags per week. And we want them to be a mil in thickness, which means it's a decent quality bag. It's not terribly cross prohibitive. And you can also have a bulk item every week, which not a lot of pill alleys do that. Okay, where we stand right now, our primary enforcement needs are early and late putouts. If you get folks that put stuff out the day before and before 5 p.m., you'll get situations where rodents have more time to get into it, or cats or dogs or whatever. Improperly staged trash and recycling, like we covered, over limit, excessive bulk items, and items not included in bulk pickup, like paint, household chemicals, TVs, appliances with refrigerant, meaning that you can put out washers, dryers, et cetera. That's a bulk item, but anything that has refrigerators, freezers, things like that. Recycling bins and toter cans stored out in front in public view on days other than trash collection day. Now, we do have, like, as you well know, some logistic issues where for some folks, particularly seniors, or people that have some kind of disability, it's impossible to get the recycling bins to the rear of the house. So we go look at them on an individual basis. And if they've got a legitimate reason or some kind of doctor's note or something that they can't bring it out back and they put it on their porch or in another unobtrusive location out front, we do allow that. And we give folks this permit so that the property maintenance people can identify them and know that it's okay to be there. So we have a log of those. It's not many, but it's probably going to grow to be somewhat more. But as you know, we've got the baker's alleys or no baker's alleys and things like that where it's very difficult. And moving on to some more primary education and communication needs. And there's a misconception that when you're sweeping your sidewalk, and you sweep it out into the street for the street sweeper, that you're doing a good thing. And that's not necessarily true. In fact, it's just not true. Using a dustpan and placing it in a bag is the correct method. And when you sweep out front, it's detrimental to our storm drain system. Everybody's seen our drains getting clogged and our sweeping equipment. Those things are not designed to be giant vacuum cleaners. And a lot of times that's what they're used for. Stepped up education, communication, and social media presence, coupled with fair and consistent enforcement, is critical to getting the message out regarding our expectations and rules we have in place without being heavy-handed or punitive to create a cleaner and safer city. Myself and I know in property maintenance, we'd rather educate and help folks to do the right thing rather than just go out and ticket everybody in sight. If we can get what we need by, you know, educating and working with folks or issuing warnings, we prefer to do that. But we're also prepared to give tickets if necessary. Here's an item we're going to be putting on all the doors in town within the next couple of weeks, a door hanger. Probably around Labor Day, we'll be getting those out. And it just goes over the proper way to put your trash out. What the expectation is as far as cans, when it should be out, and so forth. And we're going to be doing more of this sort of thing from time to time to educate people to have a smoother pickup day. And that is where we're at with solid waste. I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Station. Any questions from council body? Marcia?
And thank you for trying to get the system refined. It's sort of like trying to herd cats because everyone has a different perception. This is might seem like a small problem, but in a congested neighborhood, it turns into a problem. There are cans out for prolonged periods of time after the trash is collected. Unfortunately, in my neighborhood, because I'm at the end of a row, three different properties that leave their cans on our pavement, thinking that's an okay thing to do. And yeah. My husband and I dutifully take them down the alleys to where they belong, which we shouldn't have to do, but we don't want our payment clogged up. So I see it happening throughout the city. I see it on Cotton Street where the cans just stay there and then sometimes they blow away. Is there anything that we have in our ordinances to help address that?
They're supposed to be back in by the end of the day on collection day and out at the right time. And we are also holding the hauler more accountable for putting them back the right way. A lot of times we get drivers that just end up throwing the things rather than putting them upright back in the position where they found them. And we've been working with the hauler on that. And again, it's a matter of enforcement and education, Marcia.
And I could use citizens to speak with the folks because they are all Spanish speaking. I don't think they understand. It just doesn't sit out there. So right. I'm hoping your hanger helps with that.
It says the first step of many, but everything we put out there is going to be bilingual. And anyone our outreach coordinator, outreach coordinator is bilingual as well. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Sure.
How does it get addressed when the hauler leaves trash behind after picking, like trash falls off? I still see that they don't pick up the trash after it gets dropped.
When I'm made aware of it, I call them and they send a crew over, but it just doesn't get reported often enough. Hopefully with the two sweep officers and a couple other people we've got out in the street, we'll be able to recognize more instances, but they are responsible for it. If they're loading the back of a truck and stuff spills out, they are supposed to get it. And if I get enough instances and some pictures, I can find them if necessary. And I've told them that's what we're going to be doing.
Okay, but does it get addressed to the hauler? Because we shouldn't be taking pictures when it's their responsibility to get the trash.
It has been addressed with the hauler. And when I encounter it or I'm told about it or I witness it, I talk to them and have them take care of it.
Thanks, Steve. I appreciate everything you're doing. I brought up some time a few weeks ago about screening over some of the storm drains where debris gathers. We start moving that, looking into what the costs would be and maybe prioritizing areas we could do that, because I think that will help, you know, with not a lot of stuff plus polluting the river, and also the concept of that many cities use of netting at the egress points going into the river. Can we look into that as well, what the costs are, what the impediments might be? Because I think we can do more, as we're already doing, as you're already moving forward, but I think we can do more to curb some of the pollution that goes into the river and then goes downstream to our neighbors. So we'd really like to hear a little bit more, especially as budget season's coming up, if there's something we're possibly able to do this year in a pilot program, I think it would be critical.
Okay. I will have something in Kyle's report in a couple weeks that he makes. He gives a biweekly report, I guess, to council and the administration. I'll research it with sanitary sewers, and I will get back to you on what possibilities or opportunities we have to do something with that. A pilot program sounds good.
Great. And I don't know if there's some other monies we could look for, if there's grant kind of monies, things like that from the state or the federal. We could work with our state legislative delegation and see what other avenues are out there for funding. But I think that's just important to be neighbors to our downstream sister cities.
Absolutely.
Thank you for stating this, Steve. I want to subject that I've noticed has been a problem. And I have to say, the one positive thing is the switch to the recycling, the lids versus the smaller green containers without the lids has been a big difference, especially on windy days. However, the issue that I'm seeing in District 6 the downtown area where there are restaurants, stores, things like that, there are trash receptacles. And most people, not everyone, when they're done eating their meal, if they're on the go or their soda, it usually ends up in the trash receptacle. In the residential neighborhoods where there are the bodegas or the Turkey Hills or the pizza shops, they'll get takeout, eat it along the way. And somehow it seems people think that the gutter is acceptable for disposing if there isn't a trash can. And I guess that's an educational issue to try and explain to people that that's not acceptable. But I've even seen it to the point where people who get takeout and eat in their car will pull over and dispose of the bag or the container gutter and then drive away. It just seems like it's such an acceptable thing because it's a gutter for debris to wash down that any trash is acceptable. And I'm not sure how you address that, but I think it is an issue that needs to be looked at.
It's primarily an enforcement and education issue. A few years back, we put out, I think it was around 45 or so cans at different places around the city. And we're always looking to put them out. But what we find happens sometimes is people are dumping household trash in them. And it's very difficult to catch them. We've seen a couple shadowy figures on some of the cameras, but it's a tough thing to catch people. But again, it's primarily education and enforcement.
Anyone? Chris?
I just have a follow-up with your comment that you just made. Now that we have citywide trash, why would people be putting their trash in a public receptacle instead of putting it out with the trash in front of their property?
That is a mystery to me, but it happens alarmingly frequently. Yeah, I have no idea why somebody would do that. Because everybody, if they don't have a hauler, they automatically get put on city trash. But we find it every week. We're finding cans that are just stuffed with bags that clearly came from a household or an apartment or something. Don't know why.
Thank you. Anyone else? I have a quick question regarding the bilingual door hangers. Are they describing, in addition to properly disposing of trash, are we making any mention of when you sidewalk or even the iRequest app?
We're going to be doing a series of door hangers, each one focused on a different thing. And for the first one, because we feel it's a priority issue, we're going to focus on the early putouts and improper putouts. And there'll be something on there leading you to the toll-free number. That's not the final version. I'll forward you guys the final version once it's done. That was the prototype, but it'll have that information. But next quarter, we'll do another one that'll focus on another aspect of solid waste and recycling. So we'll be getting information out regularly. But we felt that that particular issue is one that needs to be addressed, and it'll solve a whole lot of other problems. Stuff in the gutter, stuff in the storm drain. A lot of stuff is caused by bad putouts.
And they also noticed there was a QR code. Where does that QR code lead one?
It'll take you to Recycle Coach, which is an app we have. We encourage people to use to report issues with schedules and so forth.
Have we considered, and I remember the CANIT programs. I think you might have referenced that earlier as you were presenting. And I guess that's what you were referring to as far as people putting in their household trash into these cans. However, I think there is for some type of recycling bins, at least in the downtown area, because there might be some trash cans, not many, but there aren't none for recycling. So I'm not sure if we've considered exploring that.
Okay. We did have some that were double cans, And they never seemed to work out for us very well because people were putting trash into recycling, putting recycling in trash and so forth. But we'd like to expand the CAN program all over town. And it's going to be part of the Adopt a Block program. We're going to encourage the folks that do adopt blocks to have a can in their block as well that we'll provide to them and we'll provide trash pickup. So we're looking at a number of ways to increase the coverage as far as trash and recycling containers go.
And I know we want to educate and enforce, but, and I believe I've asked this before, but I don't know if I got a concrete answer. I apologize if maybe I forgot, but littering fines, would that be part of enforcement? And should we have signs created throughout?
Signs maybe help somewhat, but littering fines is not something that the codes people have been doing. Whether they're going to or whether it's a law enforcement thing, I have something we've got to work out. But I know some people, you know, somebody's littering or reluctant sometime to, you know, tell them about it because of fear of getting hurt or something. But it's something we should be doing, yes. But I think it could be a law enforcement thing. But then again, I'm aware that, you know, we're a little stressed as far as police coverage go to be dealing with things like that. So it's something we'd like to do, but can we?
So I'd like us to consider pricing out what that would cost to get signs and also if that could be added to the enforcement as well. Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, Marcia.
Yeah, and there's another problem that we don't often think about, but I see happening when people vacate their properties. They do one or two, and they either jump everything on the front curb and don't really regard when the trash day is. They just need to get out of the property and they dump it, or else they leave it to the landlord and they just leave everything trash in the property. I don't know, Chris, whether you can relate to that as a realtor, but that's the two things that I've seen happening. I see sofas, mattresses, all those kind of things lining up. And again, Cotton Street's my point of reference. I just see them on Perkiomen Avenue. I don't go up and down all the side streets, but I just know that that's a common practice. If there's anything looking forward that we can do to give people some guidance on when you move, you just don't leave everything behind, whether it's on the curb or whether it's in the property. You have a responsibility if it's... Yep. Or it's in your rental property to take dispose of it.
That's something that we've been dealing with since I've been here. And what we do in that situation, somebody moves out in the middle of the night and they leave a pile of stuff out front, we'll have the property cited by property maintenance and ticketed. And then I'll send a truck over or whatever we need to do to have the stuff removed and prepare an invoice and have that sent to the property owner. And we've been marginally successful, I guess. I don't have the numbers in front of me with, as far as actually getting paid on them, but that's how we deal with it. Maybe we could work with the Realtors Association or the Landlords Association, something of that nature, you know, to tell people that that's unacceptable. But it happens a lot, and it happens all over town.
Thank you, Steve. Any other follow-up questions? Thank you so much for presentation. Thank you for the work that you continue to do. We're going to move on now to the next item on our agenda. And the next item is ARPA funding discussion regarding next steps. However, I'm going to pass it to Mayor. I spoke to him earlier. He wanted to address the body and those in attendance.
Thank you, Council President. Good evening once again, everyone. Buenas tardes. Yes, thank you for the opportunity to allow me to address some concerns regarding ARPA. Last were made regarding the ARPA process, and I was unable to address them personally as I was preparing for the funeral of the passing of my nephew, who is more like a son, and it's been a very challenging week, to say the least. I think that we all confirm that when we look close, one is never easy. So I'd like to do
statement now that I have prepared, that I wrote, because I wanted to make sure that I addressed as many concerns have been brought up, and maybe some clarification as well. In my remarks on July 26, I reminded all of us this fact that the text of the law that reads the American Rescue Plan Act established a coronavirus local fiscal recovery fund that may be used for expenditures that respond to the COVID-19 public health emergency or its negative economic impact, including assistance to households and non-for-profits, or aid to impacted industries such as tourism, travel, and hospitality. Throughout this process, I have done my best to advocate for an equitable and fair level of funding that will provide as many as our non-for-profit and community groups as possible with access to once-in-a-lifetime resources that have been gifted to us by the federal government. It is often said that both here and out in the streets, what has the city done for us? What is the city doing for us? To our neighbors, to our constituents, community partners and friends, make no mistake, our administration is doing its best to respond directly to your wants and needs. Our attempt to equitably share these resources with you and lift you into a more effective operating position is us showing up for you. To that end, it is a very unfortunate state of affairs that some members of this council body have chosen to dispute and challenge the process we collaboratively agreed on while doing so in a public forum. Let's remember, tasked by our federal partners to limit the negative economic impact of the COVID public health emergency, as well as provide economic stabilization to our businesses, tourism, and hospitality industries, while spending getting this program and then these fundings allocated approved. We have not yet even gotten around to being able to explain and build support for our small businesses development program, our residential facade program, nor support for our collegiate partners that provide both educational and economic anchors in our community. We can do big things again, folks, especially now that we are out of Act 47. In order to accomplish big things, however, we need to get out of our own way. I'm gonna say that respectfully one more time. We need to get out of our own way. But let us get one thing straight right off the bat. We can fund each of the proposals received at whatever level of funding we find it appropriate. In this administration 2022 budget, as well as the March presentation to this council body, we requested $5 million in funding for a grant program to support external organizations. The March presentation came after many attempts in November through February to engage the council body in a conversation and agreed upon process around how the ARPA funding will be used. After the March presentation, there were reservations about the administration's allocations of funding, which I received from then President Waltman, and attempts were made to accommodate them. In May, Council approved the grant program to move forward with the application and scoring rubric. These documents were shared with the body with suggestions for edits, which were solicited by President Waltman. Now, much has been made about the amount of disbursement. Our request has always been $5 million in funding to external organizations. In fact, you can look back at a February 23rd minutes. Our entire grant program is being funded under the lost revenue category of the ARP law. It's not our money. We do not need to tie ourselves in unnecessary knots. We do not need to confuse this with other grant programs or funding. We welcome scrutiny. We intend to be in compliance. And we also need to move forward with the process. My point is that we should move forward because we care. We understand that this is a once in a lifetime opportunity to support the organization providing critical services to our community. I urge you that we move forward. As you know, among many things that we have been doing, I'm working to pave and provide safe streets and neighborhoods, fostering new education and workforce development opportunities with our school district
and private sector partners, including helping to lead the efforts to restore passenger rail and build a first new high school in decades. We are providing responsible leadership, and that is building a better Reading. Please, let's continue to work together for the betterment of our residents and constituents. Let's do our best to account for every dollar dispersed with technical assistance and rigorous compliance from our consultants without delaying it. Therefore, I urge you once again, let's work together to build a better Reading together, folks. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you, Mayor, for your statement. At this point, I want to open up the floor for discussion regarding next steps. To begin, I know we've had some days to process, think.
Okay, and Mayor and my fellow council members, I've been communicating with you. I share the goal of working towards getting this funding to the community in the most equitable way possible, knowing without meaning to, there were breakdowns. And we have to accept that had a transition of managing director. There were people that were communicating with that individual. That's in the past. What we need to do is make this work. I also want to make it work in a way because, I say this to the group, and I don't mean to put that. I've worked over 40 years with nonprofits, worked with grassroots organizations, some of whom are sitting here tonight that know it. I've worked with federal grant reviews. I know how you make this process work that's equitable, that's fair, and also provides support to make things sustainable. And I think we can reach that goal, and I don't think it's gonna take a long time to do it, but I want us to step back and be able to look at all the people that put in applications, some of those that communicated with us, that may have communicated with the city, that we're not quite sure where it stands, and to be able to look at those one by one and say, okay, looking at their project, some of them presented last week and had different requests than what was in their original proposal. Look at each of them individually, one by one, and say, what are the allocations that we believe will support the projects with what I understand is a one-year period of time, okay? Be able to look at what they can draw down in 1 year. We need to do that with the advice of our solicitor to make sure we're following everything that's needed. We need to do that with the respect that these groups are going to be needing our support. Some of them reach out and ask for assistance in the grant application. Some of them may not do that and just put in what they feel is their best effort. Once we decide the allocations, it's then for the city administration working with the consultant who's there to help us, okay, who knows and has the expertise to be able to help these groups put together a budget that reflects the allocation that's fundable through ARP. Those are the projects that we know fit in the revenue category, that we know at the end of the day, when the federal government looks at it, we won't be waiting for them to tell us what's wrong. We will have rectified it. And moving forward, we'll have a set process that when we go down this route again, it will work. Because sometimes the first time, when I talked about sausages last week, that's what I mean. Sometimes it's sort of messy in the beginning. You get it fixed, you figure out, build on your strengths and you move forward. What I'm comfortable with at this point is not voting on anything next Monday, but give us a chance to look at all the applicants, how to reintroduce one by one each of the applications, and then be ready to vote it by September the 13th. It's gonna be some heavy lifting for both the applicants, and when I say that, they may have to come back to the city and the budget. It was going to be some work on our part to decide what the allocations are going to be, but I think we can accomplish it. So just, be taking that in mind. And by the way, just to let you know, I did, when I started on the review committee, I did speak with the consultant and I was having trouble judging them because I was looking at apples and oranges and I was seeing different people responding different ways based on where they were coming from. That's why I'm not in favor at this point of moving ahead of the ones that are ready, because the other ones may have been ready if they had come from a different level. So I don't wanna be able to say, okay, let's just move some of them forward. I would rather we do them all of them at one time based on the ones that are.
Thank you. Anyone add? Chris?
I would just add that I certainly wanna vote on these things. as soon as possible. That I do. But I also recognize that we have to set, I don't know how we vote on them as a group when we have, like, I'll speak for myself. I have a conflict with one of those organizations. I will have to abstain on that one organization. So would it be us to the total that support to not give my vote? It's very likely that when all of it is, when all of those conflicts are actually on the table, that it wouldn't even, I don't know if it would receive four, it might be four people voting. So I think that we do need to separate them out. I understand if we introduce them individually at the next meeting, we could vote on them on September the 12th. That's right, the 12th. So yeah, making sure my days of the week are right here. And that seems reasonable to me. So that's where I am.
Donna?
I also think it's absolutely critical that we take them in, have each one separated. I think Melissa, you had early on that it's a good idea to vote on them separately so we can gauge them. And to the to our consideration today, a question regarding conflict of interest for any of us who have a personal, professional board membership, an immediate family board membership, a political connection to anyone on any occasion, that should we recuse ourselves, should we abstain? Because the last thing I want to abstain on any of us of favoritism because of our connections to any of these particular groups. Yes, we care. We want to move forward because we care, to quote the mayor, but we want to do it transparently, proud of the head of the city. We want to make sure these funds are appropriately handled and appropriately dispersed in accordance with the laws presented to us. And we have had many different points of reference in these applications, not just recovery from COVID, but infrastructure, youth violence. There's not been a strong separation in terms of how we want to take that pot of money, allocating it. There's been talk, but there's been nothing formally presented to us in writing. And I think that's critical. So I would concur with Chris that if we reintroduce next week, next Monday, each one separately, then none of us will find ourselves in a position of either needing to abstain, constantly amending, or having to vote no because we disagree with one or two things in a bulk vote. I also think it's critical, and we've heard that some folks have felt that their applications were overlooked. They were lost in old emails from former management team members. Let's make sure that any of those folks that we check former emails, we're not, then like emails are considered on a national level, we can find those. And if someone in good faith did contact someone who was previously in office, did present an application, we owe them the courtesy of looking. I will restate, or I will clarify what I was quoted as last week, reaching out to everyone. I still think that's the best thing. I know that's impossible, but if there is someone who in good faith out to us through some member of management who is no longer there, and they can prove to us via emails, we can check on emails, nothing's ever totally erased, let's give them the courtesy of working with them. So I think we can accomplish a lot by reintroducing next Monday, voting on September 12th, that's only a few weeks away. If it can make it things more equitable, I think that's absolutely, absolutely critical. And let's all around this table and whatever elective office we hold, be transparent about what our connections are in this community to what organizations. And I would ask the solicitor to speak to that. You did via email, and I appreciated that.
Sure, yeah. Just to confirm for the rest of council, in case you didn't get to see the email correspondence today, but a review of the administrative code for the city does have some pretty broad language regarding the prohibition of any votes or action by any council members on any potential matters that would result in a financial interest of any council member or any council family member, as well as any personal or private interest beyond just a financial interest. So to me, that's obviously a pretty broad scope. With some momentous funding here that, you know, will be likely scrutinized one way or the other, whether it's publicly or privately. So my obvious recommendation to you is to err on the side of caution in the event that you would have any type of questions, to not only abstain from any votes, but also to disclose that to the body as well prior to any votes.
My question would be, should we disclose that in writing so it's part of the record as opposed to verbally?
Yes, I would advise on both. I believe technically the ordinance requires it to be in writing so it's part of the minutes of the meeting, but in full disclosure, it should be announced at the meeting.
And would you advise that to all elected office holders, including auditor and mayor as well?
I can only speak to the council, so I would defer to the law department and the auditor solicitor on those issues.
Mike and I will have a discussion before the next meeting to kind of come up with maybe some guidelines so that people making the decisions have a better, you know, some way of evaluating whether they should be voting, shouldn't be voting. It's not going to be perfect. It really, like Mike said, it's there's broad language that be interpreted more than one way, but I think we can maybe come to an agreement as to what would be kind of a line in the sand.
I'll put on my previous professional hat here. All 501c3s should have board of directors that should be public, so you can easily see who the connections are, where the connections are. Do your own, you know, due diligence as in the old days of solid local reporting. You as a public out there can see which of us are connected to what, and I think we will all, I will certainly be speaking and place in writing what I believe my conflicts are and why I will not be voting on those particular things. I just think we got to do it, guys, with the political feelings that are in this country right now on every possible level. Let's lead the way. Let's be transparent. Let's forego any perceived or real conflict of interest. Let's undo the problems the city has faced over many years. Let's be the change.
Thank you. Chris Miller.
Sort of feel like the caboose at the end of the train, only because this process has been in the works for 6 months and I've been here for 3 weeks. But the one thing I do feel that since this is the beginning of what will be a long process with many organizations and individuals, I think in the beginning, where we're at, it's important to get things as correct as we can to move forward. And if it involves, I don't want to say a delay, I think I'd rather use the word extension for more time to make sure that things are done correctly, that's important.
Melissa?
I agree with voting on each one. And maybe still moving forward with what we have, and maybe if, you know, we allocated $5 million, maybe moving money around so that everyone can, if we want to be fair, everyone getting some type of money, and then still, you know, then moving on to any applications that we didn't receive that they sent. We don't know when it was sent or whatever, but moving on to that, I think. Yeah.
Thank you, Melissa. Wesley?
mean, after I see the guidelines that you guys give, I have more questions, but right now, I really just want to see the guidelines.
And for clarity, which guidelines?
The guidelines to which a council member should not be voting on that organization getting money.
Conflict of interest.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay, thank you. All right, so what I'm hearing, so I'm gonna say a few things and then I'm gonna summarize kind of like what I'm hearing from the group to see where we're at. So first, thank you for your statement, Mayor. You know, I did my own homework as well and I went way back, I read minutes. I just wanted to make sure because obviously we had a lot to say about the process and the ARPA documents, I remember we received a quick reference back in May of 2021. Then in July of 2021, we had a template draft of ARPA agreements that I think we obtained from the county. And then I kind of want to read a few things just for clarity, especially since we do have Mr. Miller who's new with us. And to catch up to all of this is very time consuming. Huh? Oh, that's right. You're right. So just for clarity, for information that was provided to us months prior, of ARPA dollars, one, support public health response, two, replace public sector revenue laws, three, water and sewer infrastructure, four, address negative economic impacts, five, premium pay for essential workers, six, broadband infrastructure, right? Then I found more information in terms of how is ARPA measures to be considered when reviewing, right? One, ARPA funding should have a long-term impact. Two, it should advance equity. Three, leverage other investments, additional ARPA funds. Four, it should be data-driven. Five, it should be in alignment with other efforts. Six, it should have an ability to be measured. Seven, ability to be long-term capacity. Eight, ability to make systems and structures more efficient. So I kind of just wanted to put that out there so that we're all on the same page in terms of the use. And I believe that based on all the applicants for them, I believe they were all with their intended uses. I also want to, you know, apologize for how maybe we conducted business, but, you know, prior to pandemic, we used to meet in the Penn Hall room and committee of the whole, we would have our own discussions that were never videotaped, televised. We barely had people in attendance, but now you're getting insight as to how we conduct government business. And this is what happens. We discuss, we brainstorm, we talk, we reach consensuses, and this is how it's not easy. You know, there was a lot of comments in terms of how we are perceived and how we look, but I rather we have this open dialogue and discuss because this is part of government and this is very transparent and we don't have all the answers. We're gonna make mistakes, but here we are now. We've learned, I have to say that we're equally responsible for the outcome of where we're at today. We are, because we were provided with a lot of information for months. And you know, one of the things I call our former council president, may his soul rest in peace, you know, he was adamant about legacy projects. I remember him saying, we have to prioritize agencies, receive assistance, and interrupted capital projects. Again, I got all of this from minutes, which are public, which you can find on readingpa.gov for those that need to search for it. The intention of ARPA is to support those with true losses to pre-existing programs. And again, if you look at, you'll know when we received the information that we had to comment, approve, right? And we all approved the application. We did. However, once we received the applications, right, then we realized that maybe it was somewhat flawed, but it's okay. It's a learning curve. Here we are today. And what I'm hearing from the group is that we definitely want to separate them, not voting group, correct? So I know we have consensus. What I know we have agreed upon is that the mayor did allocate $5 million However, in recommendations from both the mayor and the review committee, we've exceeded it by a little bit. But that may not be the final. We're working with 5 million right now, right? What I'm hearing from Melissa is that while applicants required or rather X amount, we should reallocate or reconfigure the amount so that we stay within the 5 million budget and that we share the pot. Am I correct?
If we want to fair, that's
okay. So we separate them. We reallocate dollars to make sure that we're fair and that we stay within our $5 million budget. And then I'm hearing that at the next public meeting, instead of voting, I guess we would have to, and I'm going to ask the solicitor to introduce, do we amend, do we need to remove? And so I'd like to understand what we do at the next public meeting.
If I may very quickly, I keep hearing the $5 million. You know, remember, these are funds that would extend it to us by the federal government. They did not put that $5 million. That was just us, right? So again, as you know, I think it was all stated, just want to make sure that we're on the same, we could give a little bit more, or maybe not as much. So, but it's just a starting point or a point to go by.
Thank you, Mayor. So I guess that's something that we want to discuss. Is it 5 million? Is it 5.5? Is it 6, right? Because we also have to take into account that once we move forward with this process, then we have our college and university partners. We have our small business community that are in dire need, right? So there's multiple, we want to make sure that we're fair and equitable with community in its totality. Just want to make that very clear. So we have to share the pots. Yes, Don.
And it would strike me that there should be a specific amount. If it is that 5 million, we work within that structure because we only have X amount. It seems like a lot of money, but when you look at everything that's needed, some that we've already allocated, others that's coming, let's determine how that pie is divided, because this was one of my frustrations midway through that it changed. And if it's going to be 5 million, let's stay with 5 million and figure what needs are there within those groups. And then we will vote on each one, and maybe each one will be allocated money. Maybe there will be some that won't based on these, you know, constrictions here. But let's have a specific amount of money. And that's where it should come from the administration. That pie should come to us, 5 million here, 8 million here, 6 million here, however it's done. This is what you're going to deal with in this phase. Let's go for it from there. So I really hope that we're not going to have changing numbers.
Yes, Chris.
And I would just add, and this is looking very forward, but I think we need to learn from this process what worked and what didn't. And when we begin to look at granting relief, which is needed for small businesses, that we consider. If I had my, obviously I can't have my way, right? I'm one of 7, so it's whatever the consensus is. But I believe that we should empower the consultants to do that. That's what I would support.
What?
To interview the applicants, to decide on the allocations, and they would present us with the consultants' recommendations. Just looking at what has happened in this process, that's what I would support.
Yeah, I'm not going to agree on that because the committee met. They seen the applications. They talked about it, discussed whatever you guys discussed, so you knew what was going on. So that would mean that we would be starting all over again with everything.
No, I'm not talking about this group.
For the next group?
I'm talking about in terms of when it comes to allocating small business relief. Like this, looking at it and learning from this process and maybe handling
in the future. That,
yes.
Okay.
That's what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you for the clarity because I know that the consultants were involved from the very beginning.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you for clarifying. Okay, so yes, Marcia.
And just to discuss the consultants, this is a typical way that grant funding is allocated, that it normally isn't the governor makes the decisions to finally award the funding that comes up with the recommendations. A lot of times review committees are recruited from people with expertise that are outside, and that's to keep it objective. And it's done that way for a good purpose, okay? And so let's learn from the best practices that happen, okay? And let's not try to act like if we're doing that we're making it more complicated. We're trying to make it equitable. That's how you do it. Because we all come to this table with our own perceptions of the communities, the organizations. We all bring that, and that probably impacts our decision-making process, actually, in the review committee, where I might have scored someone because I was just looking purely at the content of the application. Other people were looking at, oh, but this person served the community well. I was being, you know, very, very direct about it. Then I realized after talking with the consultant that they weren't involved in all the design of the I'm not supposed to call it an RFP, the grant, whatever, the grant application. It is an RFP, by the way. It is a request for a proposal, no matter where you guys want to go with that. So when that came in, I think different people were looking at it from different views. I think I agree with Chris. We can learn from it. It will certainly benefit the community if we learn from it. And I also agree with Melissa. I think we need to look at every application that came in and be able to have an equitable way of dividing the funding up, knowing that some applicants did ask for less money. There was an applicant that said the money was over a 3-year period of time. Understanding and help me clarify, this is only for a 1-year period of time, and there may be then other applications that come down later. Am I correct? Okay, so just so we're on the same page, that we all are saying, yes, that is, so that we need to look at that as we make decisions about allocations. And to be fair to the organizations, when you talk about an amount of money, it's a challenge. And I said this before, oh, hi, we got the grant. Oh my God, we got this grant. Because it is hard to bill correctly. It's not an easy thing to navigate through, to have expenditures that meet what your budget is. And so to be able to say to groups, if you haven't been able to expend the money that you were granted, it isn't a problem. We just look at where we are moving forward. Okay, that we don't want people necessarily to bill us for things that are in the proposal. So I know I'm getting devil in the details here, but I think they're all things we need to consider.
So just to recap, Marcia, I mean, well, before we kind of want the solicitor to answer the question.
If I remember the question. So basically, I mean, from my perspective, from what I'm hearing, if you're going to change this from a global individual allocation ordinances, also with the potential of changing dollar amounts, my recommendation would be to remove the current ordinance that's been introduced and reintroduce new ordinances, I guess would be next Monday's meeting for potential action on September 12th.
So we can remove and reintroduce on August 22nd.
Yes.
And then be ready to vote September 12th with our next voting meeting.
Yes.
Are we talking about 25, 26, or are we going with everyone on that spreadsheet?
Great question. I think we're going with what, with the 25?
25 or
24. So originally, and then based on criteria, we're down to 25. However, there were two actions, according to the organizations that submitted and somehow didn't reach the right email address. So we want to consider them as well. However, I think if I'm hearing correctly, we're going to separate them. We're going to separate application, right? One. And then two, we have to look at the allocation of dollars. Just because you requested the max doesn't necessarily mean that that is what you will be awarded. But nonetheless, we are awarding everyone. Is that safe to say? Got it. We will be voting on the awards. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I'm for point of clarification for us, although that it's, you know, obviously now being by comp, but as far as questions need, is the body saying that they're going to start from the beginning? So the recommendations that were made by the committee that they made are also going to be, you know, voted on? And is that what you guys are saying, or I'm a little confused?
So 25 were on the agenda. Two are being added on, right? My personal recommendation, you know, and it, I mean, obviously we're going to reach consensus, is that we deal with the 25 and the two. That is just my personal recommendation, because we didn't receive, we haven't looked at the application. We haven't seen the finances. We want to prolong or delay the 25 that were on the agenda to be voted on. But that's just me, one person.
Right, but I'm sorry. So the 10 that the committee made a recommendation, the ARPA committee made the recommendation, are those also going to be voted on a separate base of base? Or so are they those?
The total 25, which is a combination of mayor recommendation and committee recommendation, are going to be out. So be individual. 25
clear
applications that will be voted on individually. And worse, yes, Chris.
I think I'm not, I don't know if I necessarily feel one way or another. The one thing that if we do handle those separately, it's going to adjust what our total pot of money is.
That's my concern.
Good point. So you're saying we need to add them. Okay. Fair enough. Fair enough. Yes, Marcia.
Okay. And my, first of all, and I know I don't hear a consensus here, I'm looking at all 32. And the reason is the committee, when they did their scoring, based it on maybe a different eyesight than the mayor did. So I don't think either of those lists accurately reflect who we should fund. But then it does dip into that pot. I'm going to put that out there. I will go with what the consensus of the body is. I would prefer that all that put in an application, as long as they meet the criteria of being located in the city of Reading, I believe was one of the criteria, that they have a 501(c) and the financials that are required, as long as they meet those criteria. But, you know, I'll wait to hear back from the body. The other thing that's going to be a challenge for us by next Monday is to have all the allocations finalized. And I want to be able to defer to the solicitor. If we can put down preliminary allocations and then delve deeper into it before we're ready to vote on September 13th or September 12th, that we may end up changing the allocation. Would that be possible?
I would say that you can always do amendments on September 12th, but if you're, as long as you're keeping the total dollar amount the same,
okay.
If you're going to move it around within the individual groups, mm-hmm. as long as it's de minimis changes,
gotcha.
From there, I would say you can amend on the 12th.
Could you word it not to exceed?
Sure. Yeah, that's a good suggestion.
Okay.
Not to exceed dollar amount?
Yeah.
Are you saying the total budget amount or the amount for each individual grant?
Like make the recommendation amount on a spreadsheet not to exceed X.
I don't know if you want to be handcuffed by that. I'm not sure.
Just for clarity, the amount on the ordinance that was introduced was 5 points, because it was over 5.197. Okay, so are we committed to that amount? And that's to the administration. Are we committed to that amount, or are we extending or keeping it? What we have to do to stay within budget?
My apologies. Again, it was a recommendation that we accepted the recommendation from the committee, as it was stated, with some additional recommendations that I extended for again, the benefit of organization that have been cleared by the consultants. And when I did the math and added the additional organizations that were not recommended at the time from the committee, it reached about the $5 million mark. So that's where we should be working with. Is that what you're asking me? To stay with the $5 million with the using the same rubric for all 25?
So we're adding two more, right?
27.
So in the ordinance that was introduced last week, it was a little bit over 5 million. So my question is, are we keeping that amount and redoing math to stay within that budget?
Marcia had noted 32 on the original thing. If we add two more, that's 34. That's going without recommendations, sans recommendations.
So just for the sake of clarity on the 32 applications, I know there's one that's a college that we chose to group with the, if I may, Mayor, I'm so sorry, that we chose to group with the college and university partners. Yes, right, which is why I think we narrowed it down to the 25 that was on the agenda. But you're right, let's make it public knowledge as to how we reached that decision.
Correct. But
Right. So then there was one college that we said we were going to group with the college presentation. Then there were some businesses that were part of this application process that we said we want to put with business, right? Because the majority of the applications were nonprofits, correct? And then there amongst them, there was some part of the capital improvement budget. Yeah. And then there was some that have moved out of the city, which didn't make them no longer eligible.
Correct.
So we can, we can make that distinction.
Now, with that said, going back to your question of the $5 million, 27 at this point, being when I made the recommendations was within the 25. Adding the additional two, it would be concerning that then now a whole lot of new math is going to be done. So I would respectfully ask the body that if within the new submission of ordinance, that they make it 5.5.
Thank you. 5.5. Yes, Donna.
This is final. 5.5 is final agreement. 5.5 is the final maximum amount for this.
Yeah.
I just want to make it clear that it's not going to be 6 million next week.
Mm-hmm. Let's be yes, clear. Marcia.
And I have a question for the administration. Initially, when we talked about the violence prevention, there was a $1 million cap on that. Is that what we want to do when we group those together that are all violence prevention? Do we have to stay within that 1 million? Or can we become flexible more or less?
I think when former council president Waltman and I and got the consensus, it was that we at least at minimum allocate up to $1 million. I don't think there was ever a, a formula of any given way, but that we were willing to spend up to $1 million for violence prevention.
Okay. Help us calculate the allocations and thank you.
For clarity, that is part of the 5.5 million, correct? Okay.
Indeed.
Are we going to look then to further compartmentalize that 5.5 million with infrastructure, lost revenue to go in those particular categories that were all mixed up in this? We're going to combine it all. We're going to just throw it all.
Well, remember, we're singling out every application and we're voting on them individually. So they all meet the criteria, whether it's revenue loss, whether it's infrastructure, whether it's capital improvement. So
we're not dividing within those particular categories.
That's not what I understood from the body. I understood that we were going to go one application at a time and vote accordingly.
And just to clarify, all of your proposed allocation under the lost revenue category of ARPA. Okay.
Any additional comments? we have a plan, right? We have next steps. Yay. Congratulations. We have a plan. Great. Yes, Marcia.
And talking about the next step is to determine the allocations. I would be willing to volunteer to help to sort of bring together that process if we want to have a subcommittee of council, whether we want to do it committee of the whole, just to be extensive. Yeah. How you look through all the proposals, look at how much they ask, how you come up with the final recommendation.
My belief is that we should just do that in committee of the whole.
Okay, gotcha.
So that we're all sitting here, because there's been, you know, I don't want anything to be lost in discussion. You know what I mean?
So. Well, that being said, I think we need to have a spreadsheet that sets it up that way then, yeah, that we have what their request was. And then my question is, some folks changed their request slightly from their original application. Are we to get back to them and say, what's the final number? Was it the number you submitted, or was it the number you presented to council last week?
I would recommend that you not take into consideration any amended requests at this time, because if you would do that, then arguably you should open that up to every single applicant. It wouldn't be fair to the process.
And then just to, so for the sake of discussion in committee of the whole, when are we ready to do that? Have that conversation about each application, and also we understand that some applications, there's missing some either operating budgets or some type of financial forms we're still missing from some of the applicants. During the special meeting, or would it be an additional committee of the whole? Because special meeting would be a voting one, right? Yeah.
Well, no, it won't be voting. We're looking at a special meeting we talked about. It wouldn't be a voting meeting. It would be another committee of the whole that you have requested because of some scheduling issues. Next week, so that would be what, Tuesday or Wednesday, we would have that special meeting. Wednesday or Thursday, okay. Okay, whatever day that was determined, then that I think would be the day just to vote it entirely. Keep it moving. Let's make sure we,
all right,
we keep it moving that day.
I wasn't sure if that was going to be altered. That's why. Okay, so then what day? Thursday? Can we do Thursday? The 24th. And then everyone has access to everyone's application in that shared folder document.
Except the new ones.
Except the new ones. So we need the new ones submitted to us.
I got one of the new ones today.
Yes.
But I think there's still one that I've only ever heard described. Okay. Okay.
Oh. So wherever that Opportunity House application and the RISE application are the two that just need to reach our emails for us to be able to review.
Opportunity House one of a little while ago today. Today.
Okay, should I recap the plan or we're good? Yay, okay, yes, Mr. Solicitor.
I have a question. So at the meeting on the 24th, is that going to be the special meeting where the ordinances are introduced with the new amounts?
The ordinances will be introduced Monday.
Oh, but then
what on the 22nd.
But we can amend, you're saying we can amend those amounts if there's discrepancies.
Mm-hmm. So the meeting on the 24th will be to vet and finalize the allocations.
This we can amend.
Mm-hmm.
So we're reintroducing on the 22nd. Obviously, we can amend. The 24th, we're going to sit and discuss and allocate. And that's what, right, when we vote on it on September 12th, it will be, we'll have the motion to make the amendments.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, is the meeting on the 24th, is that going to be a special meeting or a committee of the whole meeting?
Committee of the whole.
Okay.
One other thing, we have to get that notice of what is a conflict as well, because if it's a conflict, we really shouldn't even be in deliberation. Yeah.
Correct.
So that needs to be there too.
When you say we shouldn't be, should we not be speaking at deliberation? Okay.
Correct.
I'm going to work on that ASAP with the ethics board solicitor. But just to be clear, you're present for it. You just cannot be part of the deliberation or discussion.
Yeah. Perfect. Great. Thank you. All right. So we can move on now to item 3 on our agenda, which is charter board. Did I hear someone make a comment? Oh, you're good. Okay. Charter board ordinance amendment. And we have pages 3 through 19. Lead that for us. Is he on? Okay. Oh, hi, Shane. How are you? Come on to the podium, please. Thank you.
That's it. All right. My solicitor is supposed to be here. I think he's running late. It's perfectly fine.
So we can give you some time and then we can jump onto the other item on our agenda until he gets here. Would that be fair?
No, it's fine.
Okay.
If you have questions, then we could just delay those questions until he gets here. Yeah.
Yeah, but, so we can skip that and then go back to it just so that we can move the meeting along, if that's okay, Shane.
Right.
Thank you. Yeah, we'll just wait for him and then.
You just wait for him.
No, what I'm saying is, since we have another item on our agenda,
okay.
If we can skip you in the meantime until your solicitor gets here, just so we can move the agenda along and then come back to you.
Sounds good.
Is that okay?
That's perfectly fine.
Thank you, Shane. Right. Oh, is he here already? Oh, well, I take that back. All right. The floor is yours then.
All right. So, Madam President, and it sounds good to say that. Madam President, Mr. Mayor, City Council members, members of the public, everyone, good evening. And thank you for having me. Now, the reason I'm here to briefly explain, I know I only have a few minutes, right? So I want to make it brief. I want to explain the Charter Board's position on this recent proposal to amend the board's ordinance. And for the sake of I'll be frank, this bill, frankly, is a blatant slap in the face to the charter board. It is. It hurts. Hurts me personally. The charter board is against all parts of it. I mean, I could get into reasons, but for the sake of time, no. I will give you two reasons why the board is completely against it, all parts of it. The number one reason is it is draconian, it's extreme, and it lacks objectivity. And I do hope that the second and most important reason will shed some light on that part. The second and most important reason we cannot support this bill is because it's not being drafted by. I do understand that City Council's legal team, Mr. Gumbar, the administration's legal team come together and they draft a bill. That's perfectly fine, right? They draft a bill for City Council, that's perfectly fine. But that looks like the surface. Beneath the surface, we have Mr. Gumbar contributing minimally. This is Mr. Lachance's bill. And let me give you some context as to why that is troublesome for us. The city's solicitor's office for years, many, many years before I even joined the board, has been attacking the board, an legitimate board. It's unconstitutional, shouldn't exist. All manners of different words. In other words, the very person who's drafting this bill a few years ago filed a suit against the charter board, alleged it is unconstitutional. And yet you've allowed that person to craft a bill to amend the ordinance of the board he believes that should not exist. I mean, how does that work? Was there never an ethical question at all? And by the way, the president's board on quite a few occasions has disagreed with that idea that a charter board is unconstitutional. They have reaffirmed many times that the charter board is indeed constitutional, indeed was created by the people of Reading and does serve a huge purpose. So for those reasons and many more, the board cannot support any part of this amendment to the extent that we do not believe at this time that we should be engaging in any discussion about specifics of this proposal. But I'm also inclined to acknowledge and to talk briefly about the charter board's budget and expenses. I think it's only responsible to do that. The board is a reactive board. I'm quite sure you've heard many times. If nothing significant happens in any given year, the charter board's budget could be below $5,000, realistically, right? Way below what our budget is. But you do have years when there are multiple complaints, multiple lawsuits filed against the board, unnecessary lawsuits. And for those reasons, the board's budget always explodes. It burns. Now, I completely understand the need to be frugal, right? Taxpayers' money. You have to be responsible with it. I understand that. But I never hear anyone talk about the possible reason for the excessive charter board spending. It's just always a complaint, one after the other. But what's the real reason? Is it that the charter board is broken? Is it that our procedures are broken? The answer is no. I must admit that we can do better, and we will do better. We are doing better. There are quite a few administrative issues, in-house issues, that we're addressing with our solicitor currently. And we've been discussing that way before this. Those issues, if they are addressed, quite frankly, could save us some money. So the question is, what's broken? What's the reason for excessive spending? It's simple, it's charter violations. That's it. If we stop these violations, there'll be no spending. In fact, here I've undertaken an education initiative, the monthly newsletter, which we currently have on pause for various reasons. I use my own money to fund that project simply because I know everyone has eyes on the charter board spending. I've used my own funds to do that. So what is the reason for excessive spending? Again, charter board violations. It needs to stop. And right now, I can tell you the only person who has the power to do it is the mayor. Mr. Mayor, I've seen you work miracles. When you took off the relationship between the administration and city council, you can all attest to it. And you ran your campaign on the idea of synergy. and you implemented it. But for some reason, the charter board was never included in your vision of synergy. I'm a big supporter of you. I'm a big fan of your work. And I was very disappointed. To this day, I'm very disappointed that the charter board has not been included in the city's vision of synergy. And that can save that money. Just imagine we sit down and we talk about various issues, various ongoing issues. You don't have to spend a dollar, not a red cent, unless we're undertaking some huge education initiative. That, quite frankly, is the only way we can save money as it relates to the charter board. This bill, quite frankly, won't do it. I want to leave something with you to think about before I end. For the last 10 years, every single mayor, with the exception of our current mayor, has violated the city's charter. Every single one. Right? And there's one common denominator, one common factor. Thank you. If you have any questions,
May I make a comment? Good evening, City Council. It's actually a, for all the years that I've been doing this, this is the first time I think that I've ever been in front of the entire assembled body. And I appreciate that opportunity, and I appreciate the work that I've been able to do with the board and with all these years. Just a few points, and I want to say that I certainly understand some of the draft of the ordinance. I do want to reiterate that my legal advice to the board is that there's a lot of problems with it. But I do want to also address costs, and I want to try to give some perspective of costs. Over the years, the charter board has been almost always, except for one time, reactive. Although the board could be more actively seeking investigations and things like that, but I think through just prudent management and a fairly well-run city, that how that often has happened once. But there are costs, and the charter board has faced a lawsuit by the city against its own board right before the pandemic. That was very expensive to fight, where the city itself tried to crush the board. The board, with every single charter complaint, faces the same identical challenge to the board's authority, to the board's jurisdiction, to the board's processes, to the, you name it, every single charter board complaint filed by whoever is representing the administration, ones that have been ruled upon over and over again by the Commonwealth Court, waste money. The council that is defending administration is running up the bill. I don't care if it's, I won't name the law firm's names, but you all have the list. Litigating against those defense counsel is like fighting against spaghetti on a wall, where they'll throw anything up to see if it sticks. And the solicitor for the charter board is charged with representing the charter board. I have to respond to one of those strands of spaghetti. I have no choice, because you know why? No matter what the result is in front of the charter board, there's an appeal to the Court of Common Pleas. At that appeal, every one of those pieces of spaghetti that was thrown against the wall is argued again. Doesn't matter what the Commonwealth said just 3 years ago or 2 years ago or 5 years ago about the very same issue. We even had suggestions, and I see it inside this ordinance, some sort of suggestion that by agreement, the parties may do this, or by agreement, by stipulation, the parties may do that. Just very recently, we entered into one of those agreements during one of the last charter board investigations, investigation 54. And despite the agreement, and despite the agreement being on the record, they acted as though the agreement never existed. They violated the agreement, and then they appealed, and then they appealed, and then they appealed again. And now we're back again in the same case from several years ago, back in front of the Court of Common Pleas again. It's that scorched earth litigation about dead everybody. That's why we have advocates. And that's why there's two sides of the story. Nobody's saying that the other side needs to surrender, but be an advocate. Don't beat a dead horse. Don't just throw the same pieces of spaghetti against the wall when we know that there's law against it. And that costs money. And that's what really costs money. If there's a legitimate dispute, that's why they have courts. That's why they have the charter board. That's why they have the zoning hearing board. That's why they have boards. So I did want to comment. That's just two more things I wanted to mention. I am independent counsel for the board. I don't represent the legislative officer when it comes to hearings. I do for as far as procedures go, or if they were to be brought into something, but not when it hearing or evidentiary matters or investigations, give advice or interpretations about what the rules say, the rules that are set by the board. And the last thing I saw that I just want to comment about, there's been a lot in this ordinance about when the individual boards have their own solicitors, you don't need the charter board anymore. We've got several boards with independent counsel, don't need the charter board. So under what math is several independent opinions, all of which will disagree because they're benefiting the independent board that they represent? How is that better? One answer from the board that is charged legally under the amendment, under the charter, charged legally with making the decisions. So if board A says, oh, the charter says this, and board B says something else, and then the city solicitor's office says something else, and the city council solicitor says something else, that is why there's a charter board. That is why there is Amendment 1, because there is a single body vested with that decision-making process. And I would guess that one lawyer, one solicitor, one board rendering one decision is cheaper than 2, 3, 4, 5 different solicitors arguing and then filing a suit in the Court of Common Pleas and litigating for 18 months. So with that, I respectfully say, I stand with obviously our chair. It is a disaster, and I mean that sincerely. I've been doing this for a lot of years. I've never spoke to all of city council before assembled, and the mayor, and it's very nice to you, Mr. Latchett, nice to see you. And I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Comments from council? Marcia?
It's been a long journey with the charter board. I remember being on the committee that introduced the referendum to establish the charter board. And the expectations were it would help to resolve conflicts of violation of the charter, but somehow or another morphed into like political warfare is the best I can describe it, with the attorneys obviously trying to support them. It was never meant that to be said that if people would just read the charter, follow it, if they're concerned they might be violating the advisory opinion, we would keep out of the mess that we're in now. We wouldn't need to be doing all these amendments. I don't know how you make that happen though. I would hope that the people sitting at the table would all be willing to do that, to be able to understand the charter is the law of the city of Reading, but somehow or another, and then we get caught up down the cesspool of spending. Then we look at all the good things that we need to put money in. We've spent millions of dollars on things that were unnecessary. Any thoughts on how we, because I think that's what these amendments were, prevent the spending from happening in the way that was hurtful to the city's bottom line.
From my view, one way to do that is, I think that there's some, I'm not sure what mission outside council, what orders outside council get. I think one of the things that they're initially advise is that the charter board's illegitimate. You don't have to listen to what they say. Do whatever you need to do. Get it to the Court of Common Pleas. And when you get to the Court of Common Pleas, we'll make things happen there because it's county court, we're the city, and we have to go to an appeal. So I think some of what I said about these motions, like sometimes it is beyond advocacy, and that is rates that you know, my charter board rate I think is what, $195 an hour. My ordinary rate is $480 an hour. I can barely imagine what outside counsel's ordinary rate is. I'm sure it's not $195 an hour from some of the attorneys that have been hired that the charter board's forced to litigate against. And at times, I can only describe as scorched earth. And also, I think, Councilwoman, I think that understanding the charter and reading the charter and reading the ordinance and accepting that it's actually a body of the city, right, I think would go very, very far. I can't imagine that in the zoning hearing board. I couldn't imagine that. And, you know, it's a similar administrative body.
Right. Let me just piggyback off what Eric said. I think it's important to understand, and I'm quite sure you do, but just to reiterate that we are voluntary members of our community, right? So if city council wins, we win, we chair for city council. If the mayor wins, we chair for the mayor. So for years, there's been this misconception of charter board that we're just political hawks. That is so far from the truth, and that we're after everyone. That's not true. I mean, whatever Eric saying, hey, there's a complaint. I feel like I'm an alcoholic because cases are not easy. We're talking months after months after months just battling. And we're voluntary members. We're not getting paid to do this. We do it because we love our city. So we want everyone to win. It starts and ends with having conversations. If the charter board stays, these problems will continue. The charter board needs to be included in many conversations about the charter. And that's the only way going forward. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I get input from our city solicitor, Fred Latchett, please?
Thank you. I'll respond keeping the focus on the amendment itself, not the other things that were brought up, which I don't think were really necessary. But I don't think, you know, we introduced this bill in May. It goes back actually to March when Council President Waltman called meetings to discuss charter board spending. So this topic's been public for a very long time. So there's been plenty of opportunities to make recommendations on how are we going to fix spending from both sides. I agree. Do more limit the spending on the defense as well. And in fact, this proposed amendment does address that. But at no time tonight have we heard any constructive, concrete examples of how to fix this other than what's in this proposed amendment. So I stand by what I drafted. It was reviewed by Mike. He agrees this is acceptable legally. It has a strong foundation. And you know, I ask at this point, we've heard from the charter board. We met with the charter board chairman months ago. We made some revisions based on his input. Everything's there. I think this will limit the spending on both sides. There'll still be opportunities. Here will still be the only municipality where an everyday citizen, by filling out paperwork, can lodge a complaint against a government official that they're violating their charter. It'll still be litigated in front of the charter. What we're getting away from is this game of gotcha, where and there's a penalty for what happened in the past. This gives an opportunity to fix quickly So it's not this long drawn out process where you have somebody serving in a position for before there's a penalty given, and then it's litigated. You know, we heard about the former mayor's case is still being litigated. Well, under this ordinance, it wouldn't be. It would be mooted once he was out of office, once the former managing director was terminated. That became moot. And but what this also does is it would have provided an outlet to get it either in front of the charter or in front of a judge sooner while they were still in office. And there still could have been a change if that's what was desired, if that's what was the legal outcome. So again, I stand left it. I believe me, it could have been more draconian, to use their term. But what I tried to do was come up with something that really addressed the issue, which is the hundreds of thousands of dollars that we spend on this board. And I think if this were to move forward, we could limit that. They'll still be spending, be an occasional charter board complaint. The board will still have an occasional role. So we can still, like Mr. McFarland said, we can still try to avoid. But at the end of the day, if there are violations or alleged violations heard by the board, they will be potentially heard by the Court of Common Pleas, and they'll be decided. And I think under this ordinance, if this were to pass, the cost, there would be cost savings. And I think the city needs that. Thank you.
Any comments, questions?
Yeah, one of the few. I have plenty of specific comments. And again, not taking away from, I think there's any agreement that there are some runaway costs. And I did see what Solicitor Latchett put in there for that. On some respects, I'm not sure it goes far enough, and I'll with these comments. First of all, I think that I trust that everybody's for those ordinance. There's a creation. Again, if we're talking about expense and process, there's the addition of yet another person within the schematic. And that's called a hearing officer. The hearing officer doesn't seem to have very many duties except to advise the board during evidentiary hearings instead of its solicitor. I'm not sure why that is or how creating yet another position saves money. Going to the Court of Common Pleas or going to the Charter Board, I don't have a single client who would ever tell me that going to the Court of Common Pleas is the cheaper route. The Court of Common Pleas is a longer timeline. The Court of Common Pleas will almost inevitably involve a hearing on the record, cross-examination in front of a judge, likely will involve some limited discovery, but still discovery beyond what is done before the Charter Board. Anytime there's discovery, that means somebody might not comply with discovery, and that means there'll be discovery practice, which is expensive. And motions practice in the Court of Common Pleas with a longer briefing schedule than the Charter Board put together, it's just not cheaper. It doesn't save cost. And it convolutes the whole purpose of Amendment 1. And now, let me also say, adding in the Common Pleas factor violates Amendment 1. Amendment 1 provides that the Charter Board shall hear and decide all cases, not another body. And the city made that determination, the people voted for that provision. So I think that there is a violation of Amendment 1 when it comes to that. I also see that confidentiality is deleted from proposed ordinance. I'm not sure how deletion of confidentiality minimizes costs, streamlines things. I think my experience is that it likely reveals the identity of the person
which is the very purpose why confidentiality is in there. And by the way, confidentiality is not unique to the Charter Board. It is also in the State Ethics Commission, all complaints until they are determined in full. I'm just going to go through this page by page. I have notations. There are some procedural pieces that are changed, and I'm not sure what have to do with cost. The investigative officer now doesn't report to the board about cases. Right now, in order to keep track of the status of matters to make sure they're moving forward for the complainant and the city, the ordinance is now written that the investigative officer reports every 6 months on the status of all the matters. It's not a very extensive report. Rarely we have more than two matters at one time. I don't see a cost savings in that at all, but I do see a potential logistics board does complaints in front of it because we have no reporting from the investigative officer. There's a number of items here about limits for travel time from outside of Berks County. And I can only suppose that is directed at outside counsel. But the question I have is, coming down or Bethel or Hereford, which is a good 45 minutes at least, maybe longer at rush hour, cost expense is no different whatsoever. Units of limitations on fees. I think that is not a bad idea, but I don't know what that means for which standard for similar work. And I don't know what that means. Stevens and Lee is in Berks County. There's lots of law firms that are in Berks County. There's lots of law firms that do work for the city that are in Berks County. So I think that needs to be fleshed out. And Sir Latchett on the attempted limitations on counsel retained by city officials. However, I think it should also be within the city's purchasing and bidding guidelines that those limitations need to be put in, not just in the Charter Board ordinance, so that when administrators are trying to get seek retention, they have limitations right there. I would also say that if there are city officials litigating in front of the Charter Board and we're going to be limiting fees, then I would also say that those councils should also have their fees limited to the same amount that the Charter Board solicitors' fees are limited as well. If the playing field is going to be limited, I think it should be completely limited. Leveled, I should say. As I said about going to the Court of Common Pleas, I do not think that saves any money. I think it violates Amendment 1. As I mentioned earlier, I think having multiple solicitors giving multiple answers when the Charter Board is the body empowered to render the decisions and interpret the charter, I don't see savings at all. There's a gigantic strikeout of all of the statutory interpretation. That's on page number on this, but it's in 603604. That I think is gratuitous one way or the other, because that is the law. And you can strike it out, but that is still the interpretive language that would be used. I'm going to reference, there's a section here about at any time during proceedings, the investigative officer and the subject may jointly request an evidentiary hearing or request to have the matter decided on briefs and or oral argument in lieu of a full evidentiary hearing. And I'll represent to City Council that is exactly what went on in one of the latest appeals that we had. And despite an agreement and despite it being on the record, and the subject, former Mayor Scott, violated that stipulation and violated that agreement. So we can put this in and we can write about limited fees, but unless it's put to practice by the lawyers and the parties that are before the charter board, it is not going to matter. There's an extension of the period of times beyond 45 days. It's now proposed to say unless the investigative officer and subject agree to a date beyond the 45-day period. That 45-day period as a solid deadline is put in there so the matters move. So there is a finite setting so these things don't drag on. When the charter board was first created, that was a very big concern that these matters would go in for like Court of Common Pleas. It might go in, but if it gets on a desk or a docket or the wrong pile, it's not coming out. That is the reason why there are hard deadlines are in the ordinance as it's written. And again, there's a reference here to a hearing officer that it seems to be an unnecessary position since the board has a solicitor. There's been a lot of changes to the penalties. And what's I find interesting, you know, the penalties have been changed, but it now seems though there needs to be a full appeal and then the penalties will then get assessed later on instead of the penalties being assessed at the time of the hearing. And I think part of that is some sort of fear that the charter board will try to enforce something before the decision is fully appealed. Number one, I don't know that the charter board has really ever done that. Number two, there are methods in the Court of Common Pleas to avoid that and quickly issue an order stopping something if they felt it was warranted. So again, I just find that as a more of a hobbling effort to minimize the authority and power of the charter board than it is something to save costs. I also read a provision here that seems to give somebody a swing at the ball. It says if after exhaustion of all available remedies, a subject who has been found to have violated the charter continues or repeats, only then may the penalties be imposed. So if you do it the first time, no problem. And we'll go through all the exercise and we'll go all the way up, we'll come all the way down. They've got to repeat it before they get penalized. As I said, a number of penalties are stricken away. And I also think a number of these changes also interfere with the board's right to have independent counsel. So for instance, some of these comments about limitations with respect to Berks County or powers of the board that the board hadn't as being an independent board. In other words, issuing certain penalties or making to law enforcement, if I see stricken that the board would no longer have an enumerated power to refer matters to law enforcement. I'm not even sure that anybody could restrict the board from referring anything to law enforcement, but I find it curious that it was inserted in there. Let me see here.
If I could just interrupt you, Eric, it is still in there though. So that's not accurate.
What is still in there?
The referral to appropriate authorities.
Well, my copy has a line through it. Maybe I'm reading the wrong thing.
If I would it be okay, so Shane of the board, you expressed unsatisfaction with what you read and you don't support what was the amendments. Would it be safe to ask for a recommendation we can find an amicable solution? Because ultimately we want to create win-win, right? We've identified a problem. Mr. Latchett has worked on something that's problem. However, upon reviewing it, you're not satisfied with the outcome. So have you proposed, or are you willing some recommendations that we can consider?
So the charter board has a history of remaining on the sideline and just watching the game. And if we're called upon, then we respond. So I guess we've officially been called upon. So yes, we can now move forward with something concrete, not saying there's not anything in the pipeline that we have. But now that you've asked for something, we will respond in writing if necessary, yes.
And in an effort to make fair, equitable, I'd like to know what council is thinking and if you can contribute to the matter or have any, if you have any input, council members, so that we can address the manner.
I'm not really, maybe this is wrong, but I'm not really looking at being fair. I look at being right. So what is in the best interest of the city? Because them reaching a compromise would be great, but is that necessarily what's in the best interest of the city? I don't know. So that's, I'm prepared to vote on this and let it just fall where they may.
Anyone else? I don't know. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, and I understand the recommendations from the city solicitor. I understand your feedback. And I don't think we're ever going to turn this into a win-win situation when people want to be combative about the process. So no matter how we amend this, I think we're still going to, in the end of the day, still run into problems. And so I'm not sure these tweaks are going to do away with that. It more has to do with trusting people, and sometimes I have trouble doing that lately, that they're going to follow the laws of the city. Because we see, I mean, I've been in here how many terms now, and as was alluded to, there have always been charter violations of some sort. Some of them have been much more costly than they ever needed to be. I don't know whether there's anything we can do to control that when you get heavy-handed attorneys that, you know, think the city has deep pockets and paying millions of dollars. So I'm not sure there's an answer either way. It just seems to me like the fact that we needed to have a charter board and that the charter needs to be followed. And that's the bottom line. As long as they're not going to accept that and try to obey the law is looking for an out, we're going to be back at the same place.
I really respect what the charter board does, because I think you're the ultimate objective arbiter of the charter and the importance of adherence to it. I know that, you know, our past council, our former council president, our late council president, very concerned about the costs, because over the course of our tenure, and I'll speak to Marcia, myself, and there was a period to admit the costs really got out of hand. It was a charter violation that took on far more involvement than the original complaint centered on. And that went into the millions of dollars. If I could walk back now, I could bring you a whole case full of item by item, and it's this thick of the litigation and the billing. And the billing went beyond the charter, and you guys were billed, you know, it was accrued to you or it was credited to you, but a lot of what was paid for was not that charter violation. And that's something I know myself and Councilwoman Goodman Hinterschitz voted against payment of those didn't reflect the charter board itself. So things got really mixed up back then, and that was about 2013, 2014, 2015. You know, I think there's always room for compromise. Like anything, all legislation are living documents. I don't want to see the concept of the charter board go away, because again, I do think the objective arbiter of the charter that goes beyond any particular individual sitting in any particular seats. But clearly we know that there have been very frivolous things brought forward. The investigative officer can cut it off before it goes. You know, I'm just, and I know, and I respect the work that's been done here by our city solicitors. I just think there must be some kind of compromise we can come to because of the value you have and your organization has, your board has, and the fiduciary responsibility we have to the city. I'm open to, I'm not sure what it is. If I knew what it is, I'd bring it forward.
So do we need to continue to dialogue this some more? Is that where we're at? We're not.
Why don't we could vote on it. It's on the agenda.
Or do we give an opportunity to the charter to come back with their proposal?
Yeah, that's probably the best.
Okay. We should. What's a fair timeline? How much time should we allocate? Let's push it. Perfect. That sounds good. That's fair. So is that, do you think by the September 19th committee of the whole, you'd have something you can present to us? Great. So we'll do that. Thank you so much. And thank you for expressing the sentiments of the charter board. We appreciate it. And we appreciate the work that you do. Thank you. Great. So now that takes us to council appointments and discussion about VP and the board's authorities and commission assignments. Should we tackle to first and then go to vice president? Okay. So Mr. Miller, welcome again to the team. Now we must reconfigure board authorities and commissions to make sure that you are also part of one of these. It's a lot, but I don't know if you've had some time to look it over, give it some thought. We can go one by one and see what will remain and where we need to change. Is that fair? So we have appointing blank to the BCAP board with blank as alternate second Tuesday at noon hybrid. I guess no one's serving on that right now.
No, Jeff had been serving a lot.
Okay.
Can I ask a question about that? What do they do on that board? Does anybody know?
Can someone elaborate on BCAP? I know that we have some descriptions.
Yeah.
I don't.
What's important about the BCAP board is their incorporation have a representative from city council serving on it. And we basically, when you serve on them, you're on a board of directors that's making all the oversight about how BCAP administers its programs and its funds. So it's a very much high level decision-making process. Usually have a very well spelled out agenda so that they will walk you through that. I'm not sure where they're at, but they do receive a lot of state, federal, local funding.
And where's their meetings at?
645 Penn Street. Are they hybrid?
Okay. Are you considering it, Melissa?
I am considering it.
Okay, so there are, I mean, it looks like they're hybrid, so you can zoom in. They take place at noon. It says here, second Tuesday of the month. Can we sign you up? Can we put your name on this?
Yeah, go ahead.
Great, thank you, Melissa. And any volunteers to be an alternate?
volunteer.
We have Wesley. Yes. Thank you, Wesley. All right. I'm going to quickly go down this list. So second one, BCTV, are we good with Donna Reed? Okay, great. Blighted Property Review Committee, it's myself and Chris as an alternate. Chris Dauber as an alternate. Conversion Therapy Board, we have Donna. Yeah, and I'm an alternate. And then the Downtown Revitalization Public-Private Partnership. What are we doing with that? I know that was Juan's initiative. I know we did like some type of downtown committee. So do we wanna reignite this at some point? Should we revisit it in September then perhaps after we get done with? Oh, Chris, Mr. Miller. So we should put your name on here.
I'm good with that.
Okay, great.
I have a quick question about the BCAM. Would I get an email with the meeting, the next meeting then? Okay, thanks.
Okay, and then I have Melissa to Diversity Board with myself and Wesley as an alternate. I think the next meeting is actually this Thursday. Yep, August 18th. So it's with that one, right?
I'm going to be honest, I haven't been on. Have you been on?
No, well, they meet, they don't meet every. Because
I didn't get
actually, no, it says monthly, the third Thursday, but I don't. I wasn't at the last one.
I didn't get an invite to anything this month.
Okay. So we'll work on this. Because I have it on my calendar for this Thursday, the 18th. Okay. Then I have, so Marsha, you're good with the Environmental Advisory Council. You're also good with the Mount Penn Preserve Council of Government Board. I also have you here on the OPEB board with myself as an alternate. I think there's a suggested meeting dates for the end of August. They have Donna Planning Commission, myself as an alternate, you're still good there. Donna's also on the RATS Coordinating Committee.
RATS is the RATS, the Reading Area Transportation Study. That is a really important board and we mm-hmm. always need to have someone at those meetings. I rarely miss them, but we really need someone who's going to, it's a very involved meeting. There's a lot of prep work to read and go through, and you're making decisions not just for the city but for the county as well. So it's a real good board to be on. It's really interesting, but give your time to it, you know.
Willing. Mr. Miller. Okay. Martha, Melissa, Rec Commission with Wesley alternate. Melissa, Wesley, and myself as liaisons to the Youth Commission. We have Marsha with myself as an alternate at the Audit Committee, at the Revenue Committee. Then I have myself as the Human Relations Commission with Chris Dauber as an alternate. That meets monthly, second Wednesday at 6 p.m. So that would be Tuesday. And that was last week. Appointing Donna Reed as liaison to the Shade Tree Commission with Chris Dauber as an alternate. Donna to the Stadium Commission with Wesley as an alternate. Marsha to the Capital Planning Committee with myself as an alternate as needed. And then we have appointment to the Allenbach Cemetery Board. And that's a new one. And Marsha will be on that one. Do we need it? Any takers?
I think it would be a good idea to appoint one. We're still in the process of doing the memorandum of understanding.
So add the second person? You'll okay, Donna. Great. So far you're on two. Are there, because we can. Well,
actually, I was, if we could back up a little bit, only because of my background, I know you're on the Blighted Property. But if it was something that you'd like to switch, I mean, just because it's something that I think I could bring something to the table with my background.
We do have a meeting this Thursday and you're on BCTV this Thursday. So, I mean, I don't see why you couldn't come on and then we'll figure out a rotation.
Okay.
Right? Is that fair? Are there any others you'd like to be a part of?
Let's just start with this.
Okay. Okay. And Linda, you were able to capture all of that? The attendance? Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, so now.
Mark
has
a question.
Mark.
Just comment. The Rec Commission is really important that we have two people from the city attending the meetings because some of the decisions that are made involve city funding. Out there, I know it's a long meeting. We may need to work to try to get it shorter, but it's just really important.
And I had a question about the one that me and Jeff were on. I think it was like BJAC.
Oh, okay, yeah.
What happened to that one? It's not on. Oh, okay, that one.
Not necessary.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I never been there. They were all canceled. You know, I've been on council.
What I don't see on had at some point was the meeting with the school district. I think that one is an important one. It was quarterly, right? It was a quarterly meeting. Can we revisit that, please? Okay. I think that's important.
And it also, because it's a school, it would have to fit with my time schedule. So.
I appreciate that. Yes, Mr. Dumber. Yes, Mr. Mayor.
Council President, also for whatever has worked, and FYI, I have had a tendency to meet with the school district basis with their leadership team. So I don't know if that's something that council would like to also be part of. That's not a board, but it's just a meeting that I have generally enjoyed with collaborating to dates. So it's not a board, but it's a meeting that is very fruitful, to say the least.
Yeah, that absolutely makes sense. And actually, when it operated before, it really wasn't a board either. It was a work group.
Yeah.
Sense.
So yeah, I meet with them on a quarterly basis at minimum or as needed basis as well.
There is a board of also great importance that kind of pushed to the side, and it's the citizens. So I am hoping that before into the year we can initiate that as well and get the word out and start getting some applicants.
Someone from the city is working on that, on getting it started, but they need six people to get it started. She reached out to me.
Our mics on in case anyone's listening. So what Alinda said, so there are youth commissioners who are aging out of the youth commission and like some to transition them into the citizens commission and then kick off the citizens commission, because I believe the requirement is two from each district. And then are there any from the mayor or at large? That part I don't remember. So we'll look it up. I think it's just an important commission to have, just like the youth commission.
Okay.
All right, now let's go into VP. So we obviously need a vice president. Floor is open. Chris.
I would nominate Donna. That's my choice.
And I would be interested in doing it. I've done it before. I think with the time frame I have being semi-retired, though I'm not very good at retirement, I think I can carve out the time that's needed to back you up and help create consensus and serve. So I would be very interested.
And I want to go around the room. Wes? Your thoughts on, so nominated Donna. Donna would like the opportunity to do so. So I just want to hear everyone so that we can reach consensus.
Donna wants it, support that.
Marsha?
Since I'm so much involved in so many of these other groups and also work full time, plus this, plus other things, I think Donna in her retirement can take this on.
Melissa?
I'm fine with that.
Chris?
I'm fine with it.
So we have a consensus. Okay, great. So that'll be on Monday's agenda, right? Okay, excellent. Congratulations. All right, so then that concludes our agenda for... Oh, sorry, Mike.
Sorry, I would request a very brief executive session to discuss.
And if you can specify who remains and who has to exit.
Sorry, yes. This would be just for council members. Good night. Just for council members.
Okay. Okay, so thank you.